I think in the last 1.5 days, we had an intense dose of inspiration, realizing the dreams and so on. And this particular panel is going to tell you the mantras for creating an impact. The topic of this panel discussion is about public-private partnership and creating a great impact and scale through this partnership. So we are talking here about exponential change. So it's truly a pleasure and honor to be moderating a panel with all the accomplished personalities sitting beside me. In my last 10 to 20 years, I have seen three kinds of organizations who are trying to create an impact for those 5 billion people. One set of organizations, they are the organizations who work locally, a very small organization, creating a difference at that particular place. The team size can be few to 10 or 15 volunteers. The challenge that they face is that they are not sure about sustaining their efforts because predominantly they depend on the funding and charity and so on. There are some organizations which have been in India, particularly over a period of decade or so, and all these organizations are growing incrementally, step by step. And these are the organizations where I have seen that their team size is around 30 to 100 and so on, and they are incrementally creating an impact. But there are a set of organizations, which are very few organizations, which have created the scale, they have created an impact. And that scale and impact has been predominantly through the partnerships with other foundations, and particularly the partnership with the government. That's what we call public-private partnership. So when we talk about the impact and scale, the question is, do we really need to have this kind of an impact or a scale all the time? And this is a very important question, because yesterday when Dr. Deshpande was saying that the population in the world can be divided again in two groups. One group is 2 billion people, where you know most of the basic access and everything is available to them, but there are 5 billion people who still need to be included in these 2 billion people. When we say included, they need to be given the basic access to compete and grow. So the plan for this particular panel discussion, we have 45 minutes, and we have a great representation from different organizations. We have three organizations, Akshay Patra, Agastya International, and Seva Mother, who have been successfully created that impact, that scale, that exponential change. Then we have two youngsters, amazing personalities, who are on the path for creating that change, that exponential change and impact. Then we have a very most important representation, generally we don't see in organization, is from the government, an honest, transparent, transformational IS officer, Mr. Giridhar, Aramane. So the objective of this particular panel discussion is not going to be discussing the high level achievements and accomplishments of the organizations. We are going to discuss the mantras of success, mantras of scale, mantras of change. We are going to get into the nuts and bolts so that we, as all the people who are sitting here, are in one way or the other create that particular impact. So we are going to get those insights, those nuggets. And the next is that we are going to also hear how they want to achieve their next target. So I would like to start, you know, which is a case study in the world. So I'm talking about Akshay Patra. I'm sure majority of you know about Akshay Patra. Anybody doesn't know about Akshay Patra? Can you raise the hand or everybody knows about Akshay Patra? So just to, yeah, you don't know. So just to give one liner, Akshay Patra is an organization that provides midday meals to the school children. What is the scale that they have achieved? The scale is 1.4 million meals every day, which imagine now, even if they serve 200 days, not in the vacation, it is 240 days, multiply 1.4 million to 240 days, the kind of an impact that they have created. So the first question, Mr. Sridhar, is that I remember that I was in Netherlands, I returned to India. My first job was in G Global Research. And as I was in Bangalore, I visited ISKCON temple. I entered the temple, it was very overwhelming. And then I was taking around, and then I saw all the information about Akshay Patra and the kind of work that is happening. You know what did I do? In the week's time, I brought my colleagues from GE and we said that we will contribute some 16 or 17,000 rupees to take care of one child. And I have seen from there to amazing scale and growth. In fact, to an extent that when I was in Vrindavan, I visited Vrindavan, I saw an innovation where you can make engineering innovation where you can make, I don't know, thousands and thousands of chapatis, because I know in Bangalore it was predominantly rice. So what is that secret? Or how did you achieve that scale, and particularly about your experience on the partnerships, and particularly partnership with the government?
Thank you, Arvind. Just to give a quick update on Akshay Patra, we started with just 1,500 children, and today we are reaching out to 1.4 million children. The next goal is to reach to 5 million children every day. And by early March, we'll be serving the 2 billionth meal cumulatively. The first billion took us 12 years, and the second billion will be taking us 4 years. And hopefully the third should take 2 years, and after the billion, a year. Now, in the last 11 years of my association with Akshay Patra, some of the key learnings which I want to share with all of you is, right from the day one, we have worked on building trust amongst all stakeholders. Because all the stakeholders are investing their time, resources, and money in what we're doing. So it's very, very important that there is trust built across all the stakeholders, including the government. Government should feel nice about what Akshay Patra is doing, how it is delivering. For just to give an example, for every rupee the government invests on us, we raise 1 rupee from the foundations, from corporates and individuals, and we bring in 1 more rupee through operational efficiency. Okay? So for every rupee the government invests, there is a multiplier of 3 times. Okay? And right from the day one, we ensured that proper audits are done for all our kitchens. KPMG has been auditing us from the day one. So that's one thing. So building trust amongst all stakeholders. Second is, we realize that simplicity is key to scaling up. Keep it simple. Don't complicate your life and don't complicate others' lives. So keep it very simple. That has really helped us. Third is working on innovative ideas. Like as Arvind was mentioning, that we were predominantly a south-based organization and we were using a lot of steam for cooking rice. And when we went to north, the children in north will not eat rice. So, and you can't make rotis with a rolling pin. How can you make 400,000 in how much time will it take? So that's where we innovated a roti making machine, looking at a papad making machine in Punjab, which was making 1,000 papads per hour. And our chairman was an IITian from Mumbai. He worked on it and created a machine which can make 10,000 rotis per hour. Then we invested 30% more on it and created a machine which can make 40,000 rotis per hour. And today we have one which can make 60,000 rotis per hour. So simple ideas. So this roti making machine actually simulates how a mother cooks a full cart home. Okay? It's a very simple thing, but at scale. So innovation is the second thing, simple innovations, and we have scaled them up. Simplicity, trust, innovation, then extremely important element is government relationship. Because one of the key reasons for success of Akshaya Patra program, I always mention that scale or growth is not a problem for us. Sustainably growing is a problem. So we would like to thank government for, you know, whatever they have been contributing to the Akshaya Patra program. We actually are implementers of the government program. That's how we get the scale. There are various issues at times dealing with the government. There are many good government officers back there who want to help. And that's one reason for success for Akshaya Patra. So it's very, very important we invest time in building good government relations. The government officials should come and see what we are actually doing. I think these are some of the things which I learned in my years of working in Akshaya Patra. And one last thing, we are an organization right from the day one whose mind is of a corporate and heart of a compassionate NGO. So we have all systems and processes which a good multinational corporate based out of India will have. And our heart is of a compassionate not-for-profit. I think these are 5 or 6 points which I felt I should share with all the team members here.
Thank you, Sridhar. This is incredible journey, incredible impact. And I know that what it means to provide a meal, it is not just about the meal. It is about, you know, ensuring that there is a retention. People, students don't drop out, their health and many other things. And you did partner with corporates and so on. So you might like to, in the next start, go slightly further deeper. How did you build that public-private partnership? Mr. Ramji, you know, Akshaya Patra Sridhar said that there is a innovation in everything they did. And you are the person, not only you innovated in science education, but you are imbibing curiosity, creativity, so that the children will become most innovative in the world. And some of the children where you have able to go and teach that curiosity and creativity have won Intel and many science prizes in the world. And particularly your focus is on the rural, you know, part of India. Now we would like to know, you know, how did you able to touch close to 3 million children, 1 lakh teachers, particularly in rural India? You know, I know that sometimes we describe people with a fleet of cars and fleet of, you know, airlines, fleet of, you know, aircrafts and cars, and you have fleet of mobile vans. So this is a big change that I see. And I know that there are organizations like National Center for Science Museums. In fact, I was education assistant when I was doing my MSc. Please share your experience of partnership.
Sure. You know, my good friend Sridhar has covered most of the points. So a lot of the stuff I'll say probably is going to veer around what he already said. And they also help us, by the way, when we run these mega science fairs, we need to feed the kids. And thanks to Akshaya Patra, all the kids we work with get some very good, wholesome meals. So thank you. You know, he said simplicity, and this is really important. So if you want to scale, if you believe that's the important thing to do, then the message has to be very simple, and ideally hit you both here and here. So you talked about a mantra. Our mantra is 3 words, or probably 3 sounds. Okay? And it goes like this. Ah, aha, and ha ha. Okay? Ah, aha, ha ha is our mantra. And if you ask me what do you mean by that, it's just what we saw in the earlier session when the artist drew a portrait of Anushin, when we all went, wow! Because it was unexpected. It was almost, you know, he made the horizontal vertical, and then he sprayed something and it all lit up, and you kind of said, wow, that's fantastic, it's so creative. So how do you spark the ah, aha, and ha ha in yourself first, and then in children, so it becomes a way of life? And what we found is this is a lot easier to understand than curiosity, creativity, and confidence, which is the sort of English slightly more sophisticated way of saying what Agastya's mission is. So simplicity in the way you articulate your mission is very important. And you might hit upon it immediately, it might take you a few years, but that's very important to avoid what one of my friends at MIT calls the exponential decay of vision. You decided that this is what you want to do, and by the time the person in the front line is out there fighting the battles, he or she has a completely different idea of what your mission is. So the other day when I was in our campus near Bangalore, a little boy came up to me and looked up to me and said, "Ah, ah, ha, ha, ha." And I said, okay, maybe the message is getting through. So that's one. The second is, he talked about trust. It's so important. You know, in anything you do, a couple of years ago, I gave a talk in Helsinki, and the person from the ministry was there, and I said, you know, everyone's writing case stories about Finland having the best school system. So what's the secret sauce here? What is it? And he looked at me and said, it's one word. So what is it? He said, trust. He said, the government trusts the teachers to do the right thing, and the teachers trust the government will do the right thing by them. And so we have excellence. So if you don't have trust, whether it's between Agastya Foundation and the government in Karnataka or Andhra Pradesh or anywhere else, you know, and if you don't trust your own people to do the right thing, you don't decentralize authority, you're going to find there's a lot of friction in the system. So one of our challenges in India is, how do we move from being a relatively low trust society to a high trust society? So this is very, very critical, trust. And when you trust, you are going to get bitten, you know? And that's part of it, and that's okay. So trust is important. And then working with government, I remember in the early days of Agastya, it was the government of Andhra Pradesh, led by, you know, the dynamic chief minister of the time, who's back, Mr. Naidu. He could have looked at me and said, Ramji, you've got great ideas, but do you have any money in the bank? Does Agastya have any money in the bank? Now when I look back, I think, I don't know what was going on in his mind, but he took a call and said, okay, I'll support Agastya Foundation, and that's how our campus was created, right? It was a phenomenal call, because he was making a judgment based on some due diligence, but there was trust. And today, 10, 15 years later, people tell me it's one of the greatest campuses on the planet, right? Thanks to the proactive, trust-oriented decision that the government of Andhra Pradesh took at the time. Similarly, people in Karnataka have come to us, you work with the government, you have to work at multiple levels. It isn't that you always go to the chief minister, you may not even have access to him or her. You work with the Secretary of Education. Our program in Karnataka really started off when a state project director, Selva Kumar, who I think is now in the PMO in Delhi, just signed a paper and said, I want you to expand your mobile labs across Karnataka. I didn't even know the education secretary or the chief secretary or chief minister or anybody. So there are, as Sridhar was saying, lots of dynamic, good people. And it's not just government, you know, you have the same challenges working with the private sector, right? So it's a continuous relationship building exercise, as he said. Your message has to be simple. There are certain initiatives where government officers look for solutions at scale. I remember Baligar, when he was Commissioner for Public Instruction in Karnataka, he looked at me and said, look, I'm responsible for the education of 10 million kids in the state. Now don't come to me with small solutions. Can they eventually be scaled to this, because that's what I'm thinking about, right? So in certain contexts, that your capacity to articulate a solution at scale, even if you haven't already done it, is terribly important. So these are the things that go into it.
Thank you, Ramji. I think you have set such a great example to the world, particularly in the education sector. I think there's so much to learn. Those who want to be in the education sector, particularly education being one of the grand challenges of India and the rest of the world. Dr. Shiban, AIIMS, major in defense, worked in slums, started Save a Mother, and your innovation is about, without bringing medical intervention, reduce the maternal mortality, which is shame for an India, the kind of percentage we talk about. And you have touched the lives of again millions of people with the simple interventions of creating awareness and so on, to an extent that the regions where you work the maternal mortality has reduced to 95% to 98% and so on. So you're going closer to 100. So in addition to what Ramji and Shridhar said, what is your experience of this partnership and changing exponentially?
In addition to what he said, I want to utter a third sound. That's ouch. It's painful. Which leads to perseverance. Unless you have perseverance, don't even start. You have to have the pain-bearing capacity. Number two is scale. I'll demonstrate the third sound by scale. We have the ability to start a new village every day. Aha, we did it. Then you say, I want to do the whole country, 600,000 villages, one new village every day. It will take me 1,643 years. Ouch. You got a problem. So scale with speed is the key. You can scale up for the fifth generation from now. Scaling with speed is the key. So how do we do it? We started with one village in 2008. We are up to 1,100 villages now. We have worked in 1,500 villages. We work in four districts. We touch 3 million lives directly, and our footprint is about among 24 million lives. Entry point, maternal mortality reduction, because that's closer to heart, as he said. Then we apply the second part of the body, which is the brain. On this platform, what can you do? If you see, healthcare is all supply driven, hospitals, clinics, drugs, devices, nurses, manpower. You supply from the top, hoping the bottom will catch up. Now, intuitively, I'm a doctor, and I've been in this business for umpteen years, so intuitively understand that's not the whole solution. We have to start the demand side, and that is what demand side intervention would you do with the human consumer mind for him to intelligently access healthcare. By accessing healthcare, he needs two tools. One is finance, insurance, money, healthcare finance. And number two, the knowledge enough to use that finance intelligently. Since we have no money at the moment, so we tackle the knowledge part of it. And even to my surprise, it's been successful beyond my imagination. In fact, I had to tone down the numbers because it's incredible. Even I'm incredulous when I do the numbers, so even my friends tell me, tone it down. We have trained 25,000 front row healthcare volunteers to spread the gospel that we preach them from the top. We compress a whole textbook into four bullet points, and those four bullet points are repeated, repeated, repeated ad infinitum without an endpoint. And the mind starts transforming. We have reduced the maternal mortality from 70 to 90%, neonatal mortality, under one mortality, to by 60% or so in various cultures, UP and Karnataka. We just started Nizamabad and Jaunpur. This at an astounding low cost of 15,000 rupees per year per village. Now here I challenge you. You give me a group of 100 villages, I take only 20 lakh rupees for you, run the program, decrease the maternal mortality 70 to 90% under 3 years, and save some money out of what you gave me. This is how inexpensive healthcare is. We, the doctors, have made it too expensive because we think healthcare is, sick care is healthcare, which isn't. Sick care is only after 60, 70, come to me and prolong your life by 7 more years at an exponential cost. Before that, you don't even see me, you don't need to see me. So with this scale, speed is important. Now I come to the last point, and the how do I partner with the government. The numbers that I've given you cannot be done by an NGO. There is no ROI on preventive promotional care. It has to be done by a government at a social responsibility. Can we use tools like right to health to motivate them or hold them accountable? Or should we have connections with the governments who can open the half-shut doors? Or should it be a transactional window where anybody can put their ideas up. With after great persuasion, the National Health Resources Services Center, they tell me they have opened a window where you can put your gadgets, ideas, organization, structure. They will evaluate it, come back to you. Now this is central government body, autonomous body located in Delhi. I just had a meeting with them last week. To come to this podium, I opened the internet this morning, say it's been done, I checked it, there's nothing on the site. So, but then I presume the man that I talked to, the director, is an honorable, honest man. It will come through. So all of you who have devices and gadgets want to be evaluated and partner with the government, there is an exchange window opening up. Thank you.
Thanks, Shiban. Again, scale and speed and so on. Now, coming back to Mr. Giridhar Aramane, I think you are known, you know, as one of the very honest IS officer. I'm sure many IS officers are honest. I'm not just differentiating. But so because it should not create that impression. You have been part of several organizations, headed organizations. You are part of creating new acts, new laws, regulations, and so on. And here are three organizations who have been able to create that exponential change, scale, impact, achieve the speed with the partnership with the government. So what it takes to, you know, build that kind of a partnership, not just 3 or 10 or 20, but we need partnership with hundreds and thousands of organizations. So can you tell us?
See, the very brilliance of the 3-4 minds which were presented before us is the main reason. If Akshay Patra Swamiji's come, from CM downwards, everybody will touch their feet and will be too willing to do whatever they see. It's the kind of reverence, respect an organization evokes that can be one important factor. Like Mother Teresa is a well-accepted name. So the governmental resistance breaks down the moment we see extraordinary commitment or brilliance in the counterparty. So that being exceptional, maybe it can come from Mother Teresa or Akshay Patra Foundation or Ramakrishna Mission. Like Ramakrishna Mission, if they ask for some CSR from huge organizations, where I was also present, the board doesn't open even a single sentence of resistance. They all agree because of the proven track record and the trust which these people have pointed out. Apart from that, I agree that government systems are very rigid. To make them agree to something, especially brilliant things, which are out of the box things, is going to be a big trouble. So what is the catalyst which motivates the government to do a certain thing? I'll give you one example which we did in 6 months flat during 2014. When the new chief minister came back to power, he was thinking how to eliminate the bogus subsidy culture. So what he did, we had the Aadhaar system, which was there, which was all there, entire database was there, but nobody was using it. It was idle. There were theoretical battles in Supreme Court, in government, and various places. He gave us tasks that you will complete in these departments 100% linkage of the citizens with the Aadhaar card and the benefit, the departmental benefit, whether it's the social welfare scholarships or the farm subsidy, anything, the public distribution system. Everything was, in a matter of 6 months, 98% of the population was covered with the linkages. So the primary key will be Aadhaar card, then secondary, tertiary keys were created. So a huge database was built up. This is one example how government rigidity can be broken down by a visionary leadership, a strong political commitment, and of course, the bureaucracy, which will be true to its sorts, very good in execution. But it's not all. I am saying that the rigidity of government itself is an opportunity for the voluntary organizations and NGOs and other institutions to exploit to bring in innovation. Government per se is not innovative, but government can exploit the innovations created by other outside organizations, autonomous organizations. Autonomy of operation, autonomy of thinking is possible in smaller and more dynamic organizations. But exploitation and scaling is possible much faster in a governmental system. So this can be seen in various programs like Muhammad Yunus, professor was explaining the spirit behind the self-help organizations. So we, AP was one of the first organizations through government which took to the mentorship of Professor Yunus. So what we did was, we covered almost every household, every woman below poverty line was made a member of the self-help organization. And now Professor Yunus is a household figure in entire Andhra Pradesh. Of course, now it is in two states. Telangana or Andhra Pradesh, you go and ask a woman who is a member of a Dwakra group, she can lecture you about the model of Professor Yunus. So this came about because of one important thing, the trade-off between access versus cost, performance versus quality was broken by the self-help organizations. As Professor Yunus has pointed out, that the organization will provide qualitative service to all because of its nature, basic nature of self-help system. So the trade-offs which bind the government in a rigid structure have to be broken by innovative solution. So we constantly face this fundamental economic problem, how to allocate resources. So if I get a solution, at least to circumvent that economic problem, then the acceptance of the solutions will be very easy. So I feel that the dynamic organizations can exploit this weakness of rigid organizations to penetrate into the government and scale it up. But one thing which I want to bring to the notice of the panelists as well as other invitees here is that everybody will not be viewed as Akshaya Patra Foundation. So what is that which can build long-term trust from the formal systems? I was fortunate or unfortunate to be associated with some of the most controversial public-private partnerships in the country, which created huge controversy among the economists, among the administrators and all. So the basic problem was the way the relationship was structured. The risk sharing between the private sector, public sector, and how it is to be administered, how it is to be audited, were left so ambiguous, were left without much detail. Then everybody started interpreting in their own way. Government will become very rigid the moment question of audit comes up, question of accounts come up. So when you are planning to enter into a relationship with government, the simplicity of relationship must be accompanied by very thorough eye for detail. Many brilliant people have come to grief because they didn't engage a good advocate to vet the agreements they enter into. They didn't engage a good financial expert to see what will be if financial situation changes. Many times these people are really brilliant in their own area, in their own expertise, that they feel that other things, the legal jargon and the financial jargon, are subsidiary to the primary work they are doing, either saving the mothers or making the children innovative, or providing life-saving food to the children. For them, this is the ultimate thing. The legal agreement will become a kind of a secondary importance. So my understanding is that a proper care in drafting the relationship between government and the innovator will make this a very highly successful program in scaling up.
Thank you, Mr. I think you gave several insights. I don't want to, because of the time, do not want to summarize. But just a follow-up quick question. See, I think most of the things that we were sharing, it was predominantly either there is already trust building like Mother Teresa and others, and of course, once somebody proves the credibility, but here there are, you know, many great ideas, youngsters, lot of energy. If there's a concern, if they want to approach the government or say bureaucrat like you, first thing is getting an access, you know, just in a 2-3 sentences, how they should approach, how they should, you know, because I know now, I mean, sometimes that NGOs have employed several employees to deal with the government. You know, they have to sit hours and days, and that's where what Dr. Shiban said is a perseverance. So just quickly, one or two lines about, you know, how they can get an access to people like you.
Yep, we recognize this problem is a real tough one. So in Andhra Pradesh, we established an innovative council,
mm-hmm.
a two-tier structure, where mostly people from industry are there. Today, I don't find him, Lalitesh, ex-Google Products India Limited, is in the Innovation Council. So a formal structure where innovators are recognized and they are allowed funding to make them scale up is available in Andhra Pradesh. Similarly, we have organizations like State Financial Corporation, Industrial Development Corporation, whose mandate is to help these startups. AP also has got a startup organization. Similarly, Karnataka, Kerala is the finest examples. So I think that problem is partly sorted.
So there is a bridge now that exists. Now I see that the watch, Mr. Ramji has to catch up a flight in Belgaum. So he will reach, he will leave the panel by 11:45. There's a sharp at 11:45. So we have two more, you know, youngsters who are dreaming or already started, you know, creating the scale. Let me start with Shika. I was telling her that there are multiple Shika, in one body that is called, she's present here. And why I was saying this, she's a brilliant academician. She studied anthropology in Princeton University and also owned, she scored A+ and owned the prize, you know, leadership and so on. She's also a sportsman and an athlete. She's the top 100 ranked women tennis player in WTA ranking. She's the 10th fastest servers in the tennis. And there are many, I mean, there are many, many different faces. And now she's a social entrepreneur. She started this IndieCom and so on. Shika, tell me about, quickly about what you are doing and how you want to scale and create that impact.
Sure.
Of course, I know that unfortunately there's not much time.
That's okay. I'll say it anyway. Thank you very much for the kind words. But I have the privilege of being one of the co-founders of Indie.com India. And Indie.com is an impact platform where we have brands, and brands in the largest sense of the word brands, as in nonprofits, for-profits, consumer-facing brands, Pepsi, Coke, you name it, using our platform, create challenges. And through video consumption and video actual feedback, people create their own videos and upload them onto a brand, for example, indie.com/akshayapatra. We've done some challenges already with you. And upload for a chance to get some recognition, get enablement, or get a prize. And what that does for a brand, a nonprofit, a for-profit, it enables the people that they are serving, one, and it also creates and promotes awareness. And Doc, you were just talking about the need for speed, right? And we're trying to create impact and sustainable impact with speed. And I think what we have today with the whole digital revolution and the whole world that's out there online is a wonderful impact platform like Indie to create that awareness and to leverage these partnerships that you can have. The one thing I'd like to add also with Indie is that the inherent ethos of Indie.com is that mainstream entertainment and impact are side by side. So when you go to Indie.com and you see Akshaya Patra's channel on there, you'll also see America's Got Talent. You'll also see Anil Kapoor's challenge. And what that does for our impact sector, it makes it mainstream. And I think every one of us, want that, because that is going to add the speed that we need. And just to re-invoke Professor Yunus, who was just on the stage before us, you know, he was talking about the bonsai tree and the fact that it has to grow in its awkward way because of the lack of soil. But the beauty with the internet and the beauty of enabling people through the internet and partnerships that we have is that there's no limit to that soil. So this way, we are enabling the people, the students, let's say, of Akshaya Patra with our challenges, the public-private partnerships, if we get to do something with Swachh Bharat. We also enable large brands to connect through their CSR initiatives with nonprofits, to enable them as well to offer those prizes. So the whole platform is set up to partner. It's set up to enable people and express individuality.
Yeah. Thanks, Shrika, and being that enabler. Now Zubin, you know, studying in UPenn and you land in Bihar to work in, again, education sector and starting your own foundation. You believed in Gandhiji and his mantra that India lives in rural India. What has been your work so far and how you want to scale and partner? Again, briefly, we have only 2 or 3 minutes.
So just a quick note on the UPenn versus Bihar thing. I like to think that UPenn taught me everything not to think, and then I learned really, I got my real education in India's villages. So that's something that I think. To add one more sound, unfortunately Ramji's gone now, but if I were to add a sound, it would be hmm. Kind of like the hmm. Because I have no idea what problems should be worked on. It's not up to me to decide. I think we need much broader participation, and we need people who can decide for themselves, particularly in places like India's villages, et cetera. And so what our vision is at Project Potential is to create an army of village visionaries. So these are young people who can go out and then solve the problems facing rural India. Just a quick note on partnerships. So one program that we run is called STIR. And STIR is a platform for creating a network of teacher change makers. So STIR is a methodology that we didn't come up with. We're collecting data via a platform called Social Tops, which again, we didn't create. And we're doing it directly with government teachers and with the buy-in of the government. And so as much as possible, whenever there are existing methodologies that work really well, we try to source those and use those. The way that the methodology works, there are 3 parts. It's called innovate, implement, and then influence. So the idea is, can we find teachers within the existing system who have good ideas and innovations, recognize them, connect them with one another, have them actually implement their innovations, and then start to influence the teachers in the schools around them. Very much like a human-centered approach like Dr. Ganju's. I think when it comes to government, it's really easy to say, oh, you know, sarkar kuch nahi karti hai, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that that's kind of a lazy way of thinking. There are many bright spots, people who we call bright spots, who are doing a good job within the system, so it's important to find them. There's a quote or a poem I really like by Rumi that goes, there's some that are so contrary, they sicken from the cure, so save your words, O Rumi, for seekers of the pure. So it's really about how can you find those seekers of the pure, people who want to do good, people who want to do good work, and then work with them. One other thing is, there's always this sense, I was at a conference for a large educational NGO that was doing some strategic planning like a couple weeks back, and they had this sense that they had to go and speak to, you know, the chief minister or Modi ji directly. But I think that for many projects, especially in the beginning, you don't necessarily have to go that far. You can go straight to the district administration and people will generally be willing to work with you. So through this program, we've reached about 1,500 teachers, of whom 300 are currently part of this this network. And in this year, we're looking to scale that up by 5x. So.
Thank you, Zubin, and we wish you all the best. I'm sure when you come here in 2 years, I think we would like to hear those numbers, which are perhaps in lakhs and millions. So I know I think we have just even crossed 2 or 3 minutes past our allocated time. But if I'm allowed to take one question, yes, there is a permission. One question about the scale, about the impact, and achieving that impact through partnership. Anybody? Or there is one hand at the end. So my request is the brief, direct question would really help us. Thank you.
Yes, sir. This is to Mr. Giridhar.
To?
Giridhar.
Giridhar, yes, Mr. Giridhar.
Yes, sir. We are an NGO. You you mentioned about related to public-private partnership. We do receive funds from the government, and when the NGOs default, they are punished in one way or the other. But when the government defaults, for example, if the funding is delayed, they are neither answerable nor accountable. How do we address this issue?
Yeah, that's one of the biggest problems, because most of the NGOs or the innovators really don't bother about the legal formalities to be in place. They are too eager to start work in the field. So they end up regretting a few years later when the change of guard happens at the district level or the state level. My understanding is that a well-drafted agreement with performance indicators indicated fully well in the agreement itself will ensure that you people will not come to grief while getting the payment. This is an important part of the work, innovation, you should take care. Otherwise, people who innovated great things have died penniless. So my understanding is that if you combine legal, financial, and ingenuity, you will be able to succeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just to summarize, keywords, no time. It is all about trust. Everybody spoke about the trust. Sorry, I think we will have a follow-up discussion offline. Simplicity, I think that is extremely important. The systems and processes and innovation is extremely important for scale. We cannot achieve the scale unless we bring that rigor into the system. And there are many. Of course, one of the mantras is, I used to know that one universal mantra is Om, but here there are many, many mantras and sounds that became. To me, development dialogue is a confluence of ideas, individuals, and institutions for the impact. Zubin said that we have bright spots, and we saw and heard all these bright spots, which makes us believe that we are there, we are very closer to create that impact, that difference to the 5 billion people across the world for better tomorrow. With this short comments, I would like to thank all the panelists. Of course, Ramji has to leave early. Please give a big round of applause to everyone who has come together. Thank you very much for being such a great audience. Thank you.